Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Would you please put your hands together and give a warm welcome to Gervase Phinn?
Well, good evening, York. Last time I had an audience like this, the front row went because they thought it was Ricky Gervase. Well, it's lovely to see you. I'm a bit nervous tonight because we've got titled people in the boxes. We've got Ken Walker, one of the most distinguished head teachers that I've ever met, and his wife Dorothy. We've got my secretary from Harrogate, the wonderful Margaret Splane. We've got the Reading Volunteers, and I'm a patron of their wonderful organisation. But I said to my wife, are you coming to hear me, darling? She said, I've heard you. So it's lovely to see these people. Last time, you know, I was in York, I was signing books, and it's embarrassing when you're sitting there at a table with a cardboard cut out of yourself. Piles of books and nobody comes near you. And then I sense these people. I looked up and there she was, a woman in a plant pot hat and a string bag with a fish in it and a man with a muffler, and she said to me, are you anybody? I said, no. She said, have you been on anything? I said, no. She said, you know who he is, Ron? He says, I don't know who he is. It's a gardening book. I said, no. Gardening books do very well. I said, well, it's not a gardening book. What's it about then? I said, well, it's about the life of a schools inspector in the Yorkshire Dales. Ooh, work. I said, and he's life-affirming and optimistic about young people. Oh, you want to see him on our estate? Woman, he said, person who was here last week, he said, had a queue right out there, went right round the corner. I said, all right. Mind you, it were somebody. I said, all right, who was that then? Charlie Dimmock. I said, well, what's he got that I haven't got? She said, it's a woman and she digs a garden without a bra. I said, well, so do I. She said, but you haven't got what Charlie Dimmock's got. I thought, my mother said, never be clever. I thought, I said, is that the criterion for writing a book? To dig a garden without a bra? She said, it might not be, love, but she sold a lot more than you're ever going to sell. Come on. And, of course, she said, and what a funny name. Well, it is a funny name. Of course, it is a funny name for a little lad born in a council house in Rotherham called Gervase. I used to have all sorts of, as Margaret will know, my secretary, the permutations I had on my name. Grievous. Germain. Once I had sharp arse. Before going to college, I did decide to change it because I worked for a time in the Mother's Pride bread factory in Rotherham on Greaseborough Road. And the foreman lined up the students, there were four of us, and said, his name was Chuck. He says, now then, thee up front, what's thy name? He said, Robert. Right, Bob. He said, go down there. He says, there aren't farmhouse crusties. What's thy name? Nexton. He said, Edward. Right, Ted. He said, take this end down there. He says, there aren't slices. Now, there's only four things to remember about slices, says. He says, what's thy name? Third. And he said, Julian. The what? Julian? Lads, we have a Julian. And they minced out. He said to me, the up back, what's thy name? I said, Dick. I was sent out. I was sent out to the German class, first lesson at college. The question, what is your name? No, wie heißen Sie? And she said to me, wie heißen Sie? I said, oh, ich bin Dick Phinn. Then I've got this funny second name, P-H-I-N-N. I used to get parents when I was a teacher saying, oh, I'm very worried about his spelling, Mr. Pahin. I said, don't worry, your Pahilip is doing fine, I said. Here now, Margaret will remember that letter I got addressed to Mr. P-H-I-S-S. Now, I wouldn't have been like this if the secretary had been a bit more pleasant. Secondary school. I go in and I tapped on the frosted glass that was at the reception desk. Well, it slid back like Madame Guillotine. And Medusa faced me. If looks could maim, I'd be on crutches. She could freeze soup in pans. Do you mind not knocking on my frosted glass? I said, well, how else was I going to attract your attention? There is a buzzer, you know. I said, well, I can't see a buzzer. It's, oh, look, she said, they've covered over the buzzer again. The students are always doing, Miriam, they've covered over my buzzer again. 3 memos I've sent round this week. So I couldn't see it. Pardon? Hence, I was not able to locate your buzzer because it was concealed beneath the registers placed there by the students. Have you an appointment? I said, yes, I do. And I passed the letter through. Inspector of Schools. Oh, she changed. Oh. You should have said, Mr. Fiss. Do come this way. Headmaster's expecting you. Halfway down the corridor, she said, it's the most unusual name, isn't it, Fiss? I said, it is. We have a Philpotts, and we've had a Phipps, and there's quite a few Phillips come through the school. We never heard of Fiss. Well, actually, it's French Huguenot, you know. Oh, is it? Oh, yeah. So my ancestors came over with the weavers in the 17th century after severe persecution at the hands of Henry of Navarre. I said, my mother's still not quite got over it. Well, I'd honestly say I've never heard the name Fiss before. I said, actually, it's a silent H. Oh, she got out of it beautifully. She said, Headmaster, may I introduce you to the Inspector of Schools? This is Mr. Pice. But you see, when I was at school, it was an unusual name, not now. I mean, I used to go around schools, there's a plethora of unusual names. Twins, boy and girl, Jordan and Jordana. A little lad called Aztec Johnson. I've met Cheyennes, Elvises. I've met a little lad called Walter Wall. His brother was Adrian Wall. Little boy said they make fun of my name, Mr. Phinn. I said, well, they shouldn't do Dwayne. But when I saw his surname, I could understand. Dwayne Pipe. Dwayne Pipe. Little boy called Brent Willie. I mean... You know, and that little girl called Emma Royd. I mean, is it deliberate? A friend of mine who's a vicar said, oh, he said, Gervase, you wouldn't believe. He said, I had to try to persuade parents not to call the daughter Delilah. Well, she said, I like Tom Jones. No, it's from the Bible. She wasn't a particularly nice woman. He said, the names, that one, he got these parents. What do you wish to call the child? She said, Anacardi. In middle name, Charisse. He got the baby over the font. He said, I christened this child Anacardi Charisse. No, vicar, the name, it's Anacardi. It's written Anacardi. See ya. It's Anacardi. It's a good friend, my John, and he said, I was walking across, he was talking to the infants, so I was walking across the churchyard this morning, children. He said, I saw something very unusual, little faces. He said, and you know, it popped its little grey head from beneath the branches of a tree with little tufty ears and whiskers and a great, great bushy grey tail. Now, children, does anybody know to what I am referring? A little girl said, well, I know it's Jesus, but it sounds like a squirrel to me. He went into school and of recalcitrant youngsters. And as he walked through the door, this lad sat at the front, he says, oh, he says, Jesus Christ. He said, no, no, just a good pal of his. I was a school inspector and I was once talking at a conference and the introduction was one of the most unusual I'd have ever had. They said, Dr. Phinn is a registered inspector with Ofsted. The teachers went, ooh. And he said, and does anyone know the difference between an Ofsted inspector and a sperm? I said, no, I don't. He said, well, a sperm has a 300 million to one chance of becoming human. Well, you don't clap. Oh, but I used to look. With children, you know, that little girl in that school. And I said, what are you doing then? I'm doing a numeracy worksheet. I've done it twice before. Have you? Yeah, we've been practising it last week. I said, why? Because we've got these off-egg inspectors coming in. And this hates them. Does she? Oh, she don't. Oh, she hates them. She's in a right state. Miss says that if we're really good at the end of the week, we're going to get a bar of chocolate. Right. And Miss says that if she asks a question and we know the right answer, we put his right hand up. But if we don't, we put his left hand up. And then he'll think we all know the answer. And she'll just ask ones with right hand up. I said, that's very clever. Should have seen the teacher's face afterwards when I said, do you have a problem with left-handed children at all? Little lad in a school in this city of York, the great city of York, I go in, I walk through the door. He said to me, 10-year-old, do you like tarts? Pardon? Tarts, are you partial to tarts? Jam tarts, oh, jam tarts, I love jam tarts. We've been baking, have you? Do you want one? I said, I'd love one. The teacher went. He brought this jam tart, it was like a cowpat, the centre of which was a piece of crozzled jam as if it had been spat out of Mount Etna. I took a gigantic bite and coated the roof of my mouth with fat. And the teacher's going, was it all right? I said, yes, it was unusual. I want to be a chef. I've been watching on television and you can get a lot of money with chefs. And my dad says it's a good job and all, if you're a chef. Really? Yeah. Funny, isn't it, Mr. Phinn? Your hands are dead mucky before you start baking. They're right clean now. But... Little girl, 6 years old, going out to the front of the class when the teacher is marking the register. She said, Miss, I think you're the best teacher in the whole world. Do you, Mandy? Yes, Miss. And I brought you an Easter present. What have you got me? She presented her with a little chocolate nest with eggs in. Oh, how lovely. Could I have one now? Yes, miss. She popped the egg in her mouth. Lovely, she said. Little lad came up behind the little girl and said, miss, I think you're the best teacher as well. Oh, thank you, Andrew. I've got you something. And he presented her with a little egg on the palm of his hand. And the teacher said, well, I'm not going to have any more. I'll put on a lot of weight, but I'll have this last one. And as she popped it in her mouth, he said, how would you laid it this morning? I was really lucky because, you know, going around schools, I met the most amazing children. And I, sometimes I just had to go out of the room because I laughed so much. I didn't mean to laugh, but the little boys in Mother's Day, two little 10-year-olds sewing for Mother's Day. And as I go in, there's a little lad there sewing madly like... I said, stop what you're doing. He said, I've got to get it done. I said, well, I'm an inspector. Are you? He said, I'm on this at the moment. I said, what is it? Samplers for Mother's Day. I'm sick of it, I've been on it for a month. Hurt my fingers. I said, yeah. So what's the sampler then? Well, it's an embroidery like. You do cross stitch on it, and Miss puts all these proverbs and sayings and stuff in a box. I were off school, and they all got little uns, and I got big un. He's done his. The other little lad. I said, oh, that's super. I know. Read what you've sewn. A mother's love is a blessing. And I'm doing daffodils downside, tulips on bottom and pansies on top. She says, and I'm still on my letters. Never going to get on to me pansies. She give it. Miss, will you save us some of that pink and lilac for me pansies when I get them done? I said, well, read yours out then. Mine says, there's nothing so pure, there's nothing so high as the love you'll discern in your mother's eye. I said, your mum will love that. If she gets it, I've been on it for a month. I'll tell you something else. She's not going to get any flowers at this rate. I'm never, never, ever going to get on to me pansies, am I? Well, I'll let you get on then. I'll see you two boys at choir practice at lunchtime. We don't go to choir. Singing's for sissies. Carried on with his pansies. I think of all the schools I went in, it was the special schools where the children were special in many ways and the teachers too. You see, in the educational climate we have at the moment, I think very sadly, we have an obsession with targets and league tables and documents and guidelines and all the other things that bombard the poor teacher. And the most important factor in education is none of that. It's the teacher. The teacher is at the centre of the learning process. The teacher passes on. The teacher inspires, challenges, excites. And in the special schools I visited, for example, I was with Her Majesty's inspectors on an in team that went to the blind college at Worcester, New College. And I met the little boy there, Mark, who was only 11. And I said to Mark, Mark, are you telling me that you can't see? Well, Mr. Phinn, I wouldn't be in a blind college if I could see. But you are going so quickly down the corridor. Well, I do know this school like the back of my hand. And if people like you who are sighted put things back in the right place, then I wouldn't bang into them. I'll remember, Mark. And I got to the lesson and, as inspectors do, sat in the corner with my clipboard. And the teacher came in. She was sighted and was nervous, shuffling her papers. The children came in. Of course, they couldn't see me. Mark goes up to the desk. Missy said, will we have one of these Ofsted inspectors in, these HMIs in with us? Yes, we will, Mark. Oh, Miss, who will come in to see us? And she looked over at me. Well, his name's Mr. Phinn. I've met him, Missy's from Yorkshire. He goes, he by gum. He by gum. No, he doesn't, Mark. He does, Missy. He says, path and bath and he by gum. Sit down, Mark, and get your braille out. No, miss, I want to know what he looks like. I'm trying to picture him. Miss, what does he look like? I'll tell you later, Mark, said the teacher. No, miss, I want to know now. The teacher looked over at me. Well, she said, Mr. Phinn, let me see, I'm smiling. Well, he's very young, he's extremely handsome, and he's beautifully dressed. And the little lower boy cocked his head and said, yeah, he's also in the room, isn't he? Special school in Lincoln. There's two little boys, John and David, with cerebral palsy on the tummies on a big piece of plastic. And I say, you two move out. The inspector's descending. And I lay between these little boys. I say, now tell me what you're doing. We're painting, Mr. Phinn, can't you see? And how do you know my name? You've got a badge on. So where are your brushes? We don't use brushes. It's impressionist. It's after Monet. Monet? Who was he? He was a French impressionist. And when did he live? Oh, about 1953. I think you'll find it was a bit earlier. Ah, I'm talking about his son. Right. So show me what you're doing then. We've done a silhouette of Lincoln Cathedral. That's called a silhouette. Then we get this lollipop stick and we do stipple effects like that. And then we get that cotton wool there. Dry cotton wool in a bowl of dry powder paint and we do the fluffy clouds. But best pass this, isn't it, David? Show him what you do with sunset. The little boy put on some latex gloves and taking a squash ball, he submerged it in a bowl of thick orange golden paint and traced it with his finger across the page and the sunset over Lincoln appeared. I said, wow, that is so good. Well, it's better from a distance, Mr. Phinn. We can't walk, so you put it over there and we lay on our tummies. And it was a moment, a special moment for me. And we lay there just looking at this picture of the sunset over Lincoln. I said, do you think I might have that painting? And I'll swap it you for some of my books. Oh, you can have it, Mr. Phinn. How many do you want? We can rattle them off. And I said, one is fine. I'll collect it later when it's dry. And I got up to go, and I was wearing a dark suit, and as I got up, little David had a kind of spasm, and the squash ball shot out of his hand, and it hit me straight between the legs. I stood there with a codpiece of mammoth proportions, I was like Ian McKellen playing the Sun King Richard II. It was a golden orb with tendrils of gold. And if you've ever heard children shriek with laughter, they rolled, the paint went everywhere. The teacher took a handkerchief out of a bag and stuffed it in her mouth. The classroom assistant disappeared to return a moment later with a wet sponge. I said, no, I shall go to the cloakroom and deal with it. And I transformed that wonderful golden codpiece into a dirty brown dribble. But I got my Ofsted clipboard, and covering over that part of my anatomy went to the next lesson. But a child, a little girl, with eyes like an eagle, manoeuvred her wheelchair round. She'd seen a dribble of brown, and she lifted the clipboard. She fetched a friend. And another friend. And finally, all the class was staring at this big brown stain on my trousers until she said to the teacher, Miss, you better come. This man in the corner's just done a runny poo. Well, I went to the secretary's office and said, I'm going back to the hotel to change. She said, oh, don't worry, Mr. Phinn, the children have little accidents. I said, no, it wasn't a little accident, it's paint. Well, there's a laundry in the school. The laundress will clean them for you. It's only powder paint. Along to the laundry I go. The laundress said, well, you have to take the trousers off if you put those white cotton ones on the ancillary staff and the medical staff wear. And your coat is spattered, so give me that as well. Put the white top on. So I put the white coat on, matching white cotton trousers, put my Ofsted badge under here, took my clipboard and set off for the next lesson of the day. Now, I've never been greeted as I was that morning. For as I turned the corridor corner, the woman waiting outside her classroom, the one I was going to visit, saw me. Come on. I said, you, come on. Come on, chop, chop. Well, I shot down. I said, yes, I said, good morning. If I may, shh, don't say anything. Did you see any? I said, did you see any? Any what? We've got school inspectors in this week. Didn't you know? Oh, yes. I said, if I should... Shh. I bet you I get the one that looks as if he's being dug up. They're horrible. They go in your drawers, they rootle through your bags, they go in your storerooms. I'm sick of it. I've had it up to here. I've not slept for 3 months. I know I'll get one. Anyway, I'm not starting till he comes. He's going to see a beginning, middle and end if it kills me. Anyway, you better go. Damien, come on, love, your physiotherapist's here. I said, no, he isn't. Pardon? No, he isn't. You're not the physio? I said, no, I'm not. Well, who are you? Should have a badge. I said, I do have a badge. But before I show you my badge, could I ask you something? What? Have you a weak heart? No, because I'm going to show you something now that might cause just a trifle distress. Well, what? Ofsted. You're not. No, you're not. I said, you're all in white. We sometimes come incognito, you know. You think that's the window cleaner up the ladder, it's the chief inspector. Special schools. Special schools. My office was in Harrogate, and Harrogate's not really like any other part of Yorkshire, really. So I thought it was all like the Cheltenham of the north. I mean, Harrogate is a special town. I mean, the fire brigade is ex-directory, and the residents have the big issue delivered, and the seagulls fly upside down as they go over the town. It's a very unusual place, and Dickens said of Harrogate, it's the queerest place with the strangest customs and the oddest people. And I came from Rotherham, you see. I moved from Rotherham to Harrogate, and it was a great culture shock. Because in Rotherham, people are very friendly. You know, they'll call you love and they'll stand at the bus stop. Harrogate's a bit different, particularly if you go to get some stamps from the Harrogate High Post Office, where it's the only one I know with a chaise longue. And there in front of me were two elegant elderly ladies, one with a designer Zimmer. And it was a wonderful little exchange. She said, do you think that Placido Domingo is his real name, Joyce? She said, I beg your pardon, Dorothy. You know Placido Domingo? No, I don't. Never met him. No, I know you haven't met him, but you've heard of him, I haven't. You have. He's a singer, he's Spanish. And I'm mooting whether Placido Domingo is his real name, because after all, it means in English, Placid Domino, doesn't it? She said, have you had your tablets? Look, I'm merely asking if it's his real name. The other one said, whose real name, dear? I interrupted and said, excuse me, it is his real name. They swiveled round. She said, did anybody ask you to interrupt this conversation? She said, you're coming to get your pension, you're harassed. And the other woman gave me a withering look and said, oh, she said, Harrogate's gone down. And then I took this American inspector to Betty's. You know, he said, I want to go, Gervase, to the best tea room in the world, here in Harrogate, Betty's tea room. Well, of course, there's a little brass plaque in Betty's in Harrogate, please wait. He went straight past, sat, went to a corner table where two elegant elderly ladies were having afternoon tea. And he said, may we join you, ladies? She said, certainly not. She said, you have your own table at Betty's, and furthermore, you should queue. Well, we sat on the next table, and he said to me, Gervase, tell me, he was listening to him, tell me, is this rehearsed? He said, it's like Alan Bennett. It was. It was Alan Bennett there. It must have been a monologue. She was saying, one was saying, you know, she said, I was up and down those steps like a shuttlecock. I think she meant a yo-yo. She said, if I vomited once, I vomited four times. And we always come back through St. Malo, but of course this year he would insist Sydney. Oh, yes. Come back through Cherbourg. It was mountainous, the sea. Mountainous at Cherbourg. Up and down. I was in the ladies' lavatory even and splashing. The sea was outside even and splashing. And where was Sydney? Well, I was tempted to lean over and say, well, where was Sydney? She said, I'll tell you where Sydney was. To a friend. She said, in the restaurant with a French bap, a lump of camembert, and a bottle of red wine, totally static. I'll tell you, if it had been on the Titanic, he wouldn't have got up. Then he comes up and pats me on the back and says, are you all right? And I'm green in the gills. I've never been so glad to get my feet on terracotta. Now, I love that. I love that because it's part of this wonderful, rich, poetic language of ours. And in my book, if you read my book, you'll come across the cleaner at the Teacher Centre, Connie. She was a mistress of the malapropism. She could mince words like a mincer minces the best fillet steak. She used to make words up like Shakespeare. She'd say to me, oh, Gerv, you're so artificated. There's a man at the side of the... over there, look, is testiculating. That ought to be in the Oxford English Dictionary, to testiculate. She had these wonderful expressions. Ooh, she said, that woman, she's got a mouth like a torn pocket. Is that wonderful? You know, an expression like last year's rhubarb. I loved it. I used to listen to her. She was wonderful. She, when the teacher centre had the new sound system put in, she said, oh, they put that new microphone in there, so I think you'll find the agnostics are very good. Mr. Phinn, could I have a word with you a moment? She said, people have been making certain allegations about me. I said, well, I can assure you it's not me. No, but somebody has been making allegations. And if I find out who the alligator is... She said, you're putting on weight, you know. She said, you want to go on to, off the butter, go on to that monosodom and what they call it, sodomite. She said, that'll calm you. And then Paula, she said, I said, how's your Paula? Then she said, oh, our Paula, she didn't get the job. She gets to the last interview and never gets it. You see, the trouble is, Mr. Phinn, she's too self-defecating. I said, well, I think it'd go against her at interview, that, to be honest. I love that. And my mother said when I was young, you know, and it's the best advice, watch, listen, observe, because that is the actual material for writing and for a lot of humour. And often the humour is quite unconscious. You know, the famous one of Connie was, you know, when the creeper crept over the wall and across the path, and she came in and said, we're going to have somebody fall a cropper there, you know. She said, it wants cut. I said, well, take the parts, get the parts department to cut it back. Up comes the science inspector. No, he said, tell them it's not the time of year to cut it back. It's a clematis. It's a what? It's a clematis. Never heard of it. What's one of them when it's about? It's a very rare clematis, it's a rubana. He said, and if they are going to come, tell them to trim it to the path, but not to cut it right back, they'll kill it. It's a what? It's a clematis. It's a very rare plant. We're all having our coffee. She comes in with a tea tray. She said, oh, Mr. Phinn, the parks department have been and they've cut that clitoris right back. I said, oh. So nobody will slip now. But you see, Harrogate was fascinating, but it was the Dales that were my deep love. Swaledale and Nidderdale and Wensleydale. And when you meet that little boy in a little nursery in the Dales, little Yorkshire little laddie, in a big cardboard box, and you can't see him, you just see the box moving from side to side. And I look at him and I say, are you in your racing car? No, I'm in a cardboard box. Little lad, I said, come over you to the window. And what's your name? He says, well, my mum calls me Thomas and my dad calls me Tom. What shall I call you? That can answer to either. Right, I thought I'd test him on his number work. I said, tell me, Tom, how many sheep can you see in that field? He said, all of them. I said, well, I'd like to count them. I don't need to, there's 28. How do you know there's 28 sheep in that field without counting them? Because they're our sheep, that's why. Do you know who I am, Tom? Ah, you're inspector, aren't you? The inspector. Our teacher's dead freaking to thee. She's been in all weekend putting that display up, so you better look at it. Here. She's had her hair done this week. You're going to ask me questions. I'm going to ask you to do something for me. You're looking up there at Wensleydale, one of the most beautiful views. Imagine that I'm unable to see it, and you are going to describe it for me, Tom. You're going to embroider a picture in words. Do you mean tell you what it looks like? That is it. Well, he said there's hills at the top with a few clouds. There's a pine wood that goes round. It belongs to Barclay. Him, he's cut it right too. He's cut it too far. My dad's reported him to Yorkshire Dales for that. I'll tell you something else then about Barclay. See down there, there's a barn. He's turning it into a holiday home. Well, my granddad's going to wait until it's all built, then he's going to report him for that, because he hasn't got planning permission. He's sick of Barclay. Thinks he owns Alt Dale. And he's an off-Cumden, is he? Ah. An alien foreigner, an off-Cumden. You have to be five generations to be accepted there. Is that what you want me to... I said, well, let me tell you what I see through maybe a poet's eyes, Tom. I see the distant purple peaks shrouded in a fleecy mist. I see the pine-scented woodland stretching around in a dark green belt. Stay a moment, Tom, and observe the undulating greens of the Great Dale, flecked with winter sunlight and dotted with lazy-looking sheep. His little face. See the rusty red beck as it trickles between the silvered limestone walls creviced with tiny pink gillyflowers. That is what I see. Yeah. Well, I know how to make babies. I said, really? We did it yesterday. I know how to do it now. Good. Do you know how to make babies then, Mr. Phinn? Yes, I do. Well, how do you make babies then? I said, you go first. He said, well, I knock the Y off and put IES. So I make babies. Now, you see, for the Dales child, a farming child, the facts of life, well, the facts of life, unlike the urban child, you know, that we learnt in the playground, it was almost like a dirty word, a dirty phrase, the facts of life. People didn't speak. But in the Dales, of course, they see life and death all around them. And I visited a school in the Dales, and I'd been there 2 years before, and as I walk in the door, the children were the older ones, the juniors, and I walk in and I said to them, "Now, children," I said, "do you remember me?" "Little Dales lad." "No, should we?" I said, "I came in your school 2 years ago, and I remember coming." "Do you? Are you a man that does monumental rubbings with tissue paper and stuff?" I said, "No." "Who are you then?" I said, "I used to come in and I tested your reading." "Ooh, aye, I remember you now." I said, "Well, I remember this school because I parked my car down that track outside the school. And as I got out to get my briefcase from the back, I turned and came face to face with the most enormous bull that I've ever seen." "Oh, aye, were you a Belgian Blue?" I said, "I'm not sure what it was, but it was a huge bull eye to be a Belgian Blue, I think, two years ago." "They have a muscle on a muscle they call Schwarzenegger bulls. Great big bulls, they're pale brown and white. Great big bulls, that's it." "Were it debuddered?" I said, "Was it? Were it debuddered?" "I'm sorry?" "Had it got all horns on its head?" I said, "Yes." "Well, it weren't debuddered then. You see, you burn your horns for 3 months. Stop them hurting the sense. And others. They used to swap round fields. He were Hightower." "Aye. Great big bull he were. Dead." "Pardon? He's dead." "Is it? Aye." "Right. Only bull we have up this part at Dale now is bull in a test tube. Bull we a bowler at." "Who's that?" "AI man, artificial inseminator. He comes in, does bulls, no messing." Other little lad looked up from his work. "French sperm's better quality than Belgian sperm, you know." "You can get it from Bentham Market before 10:30 on a Thursday." I said, "Well, thank you very much for that. I was wondering what to get my wife for her birthday." "Dead that bull. Do you want to know what happened to him?" "Well, yes." "Cows were making hell of a noise. Hell of a noise. He were ready for them. He went through a bar gate. He went through an hawthorn hedge before Mester come with tractor. Blocked him off. He charged tractor, bust an horn, got an infection and were put down." "Isn't that the idea of the bull and the cows? You know?" "What?" "Well, that's why you have bulls and cows, isn't it? Presumably you want him to get to the cows." "No, no," the lad said. "No, no. If he'd have got in that field, you're talking a ton and a half a bull. He'd have broke every back in field. They don't do it like that." "All right, well, let's look at your book, shall we?" I said, "No. In olden days, they dug a pit, put your cow in, and 8 men lowered your bull on top with leather straps. You lowered him on, and you pulled him off. You lowered him on," I said, "I've got it," and we pulled it. I said, "I've got it. We're loading him on," I said, "and we're pulling him off. I've got it. I've got it." "But they don't do it like that now. They have a serving cage. So they winch him on and they winch him off." I said, "Right, we're winching him on, winch him off." Other little lad looked up and said, "My dad said it's not a bad life." I said, let's look at your book. You see, we're talking a lot of money. Pride of Brussels at Great Yorkshire Show, we're 40,000 quid. Oh, it happens like that. Right. Bull in Topfield that were debuddered, he's dead and all. All right. Do you want to know how he died? Well, if I must. He had an accident, did he? What was that? Well, that Belgian Blues sometimes have. And what's that? You know, I don't know. You do? I said, I do not know. Well, sometimes they get carried away when they're doing what comes natural. And he did. And his penis snapped. Well, I went to the window to look out over the Dale Crimson and a voice came across the classroom behind me. "It's all right, Mr. Phinn. It only happens with bulls." The Dales children. And you know, when sometimes I met these children, it was quite obvious to me that what my mother used to say, everyone in the world, she said, has a talent. that nobody else possesses. You do and I do. And every one of us in the world has a special need, which nobody else has too. Nobody is perfect and good at everything. You might be massively academic, but you might be have special needs in other areas. And when I went sometimes in the Dales, I met children who had really such low self-esteem sometimes. I met children in schools. And see, I was brought up with a mum and dad that were just wonderful. And they always said that I was as good as anybody, that I could achieve anything if I put my mind to it, to work hard and aim for the moon, and in doing so, might just end up dwelling amongst the stars. I went through life believing in myself and also having people behind me who expected so much of me. And I'm very fortunate to have that, I've had that, because some children don't. And it is a fact that some children are told by adults that they are a waste of space, or fools, or idiots. The worst thing you can say to children, to call them a fool, or an idiot, or stupid. And once in the Dales, a little boy in the corner of the classroom, I went over and said, he was 11, I said, may I look at your book? It was Wensleydale again. No, sir. I said, pardon? No, sir. I can't look at your book. No, sir. And his bottom lip was trembling. I said, am I frightening you? Yes, sir. Why? Sir, because you're the inspector and you're going to look at my book and it's no good, sir. I said, well, it's your book. And if you don't want me to look at it, I won't look at it. Sir, why don't you go and talk to somebody else? I'm remedial. I said, you're what? I'm remedial, sir. I can't do things. Remedial, sir. Means sort of stupid, thick and stupid, can't do things. Where do you live? Pardon, sir? I said, where do you live? I live at the top of the Dale, sir, up there. Gosh. You look down on that view, do you? Yes, sir. I wasn't looking at view this morning because I was up early helping my dad deliver a calf and it were dead. Ah, it was dead. We got ratchet on. We caught vet out. It's really expensive. So we got Charolais and we used to have limousines, but now we had ratchet on the back end of it and it got its cord wrapped round and now we're on ratchet. I said, just what is the ratchet then? Well, it's a kind of metal thing you put up back of your cow and you get your ropes round. If you can't deliver well, if you can't deliver properly, you put your ropes round and back legs of your calf and you turn it to a contraction. Do you know what a contraction is, sir? I said, I do know what one is. I've never had one, but I have seen quite a few. It was dead, sir. Right. And his mother were a good milker. She had a lovely back end like a box and good udder texture. Would have been a good milker, that. Oh, I'm sorry. And we had trouble week before, so we oggies. I said, the what? Oggies. Oggies? What are they? Are they pigs? No, sir. Your oggies, your teenage sheep. It's been your lamb and your ewe, you have your ogget. Do you know what a stirk is, sir, or a gimmer, or a tup, or a yarm? I said, no. You don't know much, sir, do you? No. I'm remedial. And I got a smile. You see, there is the expert in the presence of the ignoramus. We had trouble a week before that, sir, when my dad got a jock from Bentham. Do you know what a jock is, sir? Scottish sheep? No. No, it's a ram. One ram and the rest are yows or ewes. Do you know why? I said, I do. Well, it said only took 3 yows. Do you know what? I said, I do. Know what that. No. It only took 3 yows and it dropped dead. He dropped a heart attack, I think. He just went over. My dad took it back. Well, I would have done. So when my dad's had a week like that, sir, he comes home and he flops on settee and he's got a word he uses. All right, well, I'll move on with the word. No, it's not a rude word. It's what a sheep does when she's heavy with lamb and all her fleece is matted and gungy and she can't get up because she's heavy with maybe 2 lambs and she goes over on her back and she sticks her legs in air. She's helpless. She's helpless, sir, because she's rig-weltered. I say, she's what? She's rig-weltered. It means on your back with your legs stuck up in air. Totally helpless, sir. Can't do out. Can't do out. If you don't roll her over in 15 minutes, she'll be dead. Rig-weltered, you see. Right. I was speaking at the North of England Conference in York in the presence of the then Secretary of State for Education, Mrs. Gillian Shepherd, who I recall as being a small woman in boots. And she said to me, tell me, Mr. Phinn, tell me, Mr. Phinn, how's the national curriculum going in the north of England? I said, well, Mrs. Shepherd, the teachers are feeling somewhat rig-weltered. You've got to say, though, Yorkshire is blunt, isn't it? It is a blunt place. Little lad in Barnsley, first day of term. I'm in with the head, infant school. Little face appears above the glass, the door. He's 5 years old, his first day at school. She opens the door and he's standing there with his pants and his underpants around his ankle. The headmistress says, what are you doing? He said, so who wipes the arses around here then? Little lad. I've had a lovely tour so far. I've been over to Belfast. Oh, I went over last to Belfast. I went during the Good Friday Agreement negotiations. And I was a bit worried, to be honest, but I found the people I'd never been before, the most amazingly hospitable people you could meet, with a wonderful command of language. It's actually, for the connoisseur of the colloquial, it's a paradise. It really is, you know. You'd hear conversations at the bus stop, you know, when they were talking about one of the terrorists. And she said, aye, she says, when they found the arms on him, he hadn't a leg to stand on. Wonderful descriptions. And when I was there, there were all these posters around with the Reverend Paisley stabbing the air with a finger. Because he was against it at the time. Ulster says no. Ulster says no. Gentleman's toilet in Belfast Station above the urinal. Ulster says no. I couldn't go to the toilet. I went to wash my hands and over the wash basin. Ulster says no. But somebody had written underneath, but the man from Del Monte, he say, yes. And somebody had written underneath that, and he's an orange man. You see, what I found in that place, where there is strife and trouble and heartache and violence and murder and everything else, humour like a small light comes through and it binds people together, because people laughing together, sharing something they find amusing, tends to bring them together. And if you're laughing, you're not fighting. And what was so amazing out there, you'll go down the Shankill Road and somebody had written in great letters, no Pope here. And somebody had written in equally large letters underneath, lucky old Pope. I was on the Jerry Kelly show and he said, we have over the water Gervase Phinn. I never heard of him. In fact, I thought it was a woman who did Tina Turner tributes. But he's a chap from Yorkshire, and he's going to be talking about his books about the Yorkshire Dales. But first of all, we'll play a record for Rosemary O'Malley of the Gavaki Road. Rosemary has requested a record for her dear grandfather. And Gervase says, will you look at this now? Will you look at this? Rosemary O'Malley's grandfather, 111 years old. Gosh gracious, Gervase, do you think he'll ever reach 111? I said, I don't. Oh, gosh, I wonder what the secret is of this man's life. We're going to play for Joseph O'Malley, the great 111-year-old. We're going to play for him Danny Boy, sung by Daniel O'Donnell. Producer came in and whispered something in the Jerry's ear. Came on again. We've just had my producer in. He'd like to invite Joseph O'Malley of the Gavaki Road to come in and talk about his lovely, lovely long life. And we're going to play another special record for him, Joseph Locke, the great Joseph Locke, singing Galway Bay. Producer came in again while it was playing, it whispered in his ear, came on the air again. We have just received a phone call from Rosemary O'Malley of the Gavaki Road. I need to tell you that her grandfather, Joseph, is not 111 years old. He's ill. Ireland. I love the variety in life, you know? I love the variety in life. And of course, you go to Ireland, and then the next week I was up at old Gordon Brown, where Gordon Brown was educated, right up there in Scotland. And when I was going up there, the phone call came from a nun in a little Catholic school. She says, I'm wanting, Gervase, for you to come up to Glasgow and work with my wee children. I said, oh, well, sister, I said, I can't. God said that you would come up. I said, who did? God. He spoke to me last night and said, Gervase is going to come up to work with these children. I said, well, God's not said anything to me, sister. No, Gervase, but he said when you're on your knees tonight, he will mention it. I phoned her the next day. I said, God's been in touch. Did he mention fees, Gervase? No, he didn't to me either. And I went up to this school. Oh, it was the nativity time. And they were doing the nativity. And Mary came on all in blue with a safety pin under here. And Joseph, in a multicoloured towel draped over his head, held in place with an elastic belt with a snake clasp. He was wearing a Care Bear dressing gown and red socks. And they came on holding hands. And there in the manger was baby Jesus. It was the biggest doll I have ever seen. It must have weighed, if it was real, about 30 pounds. It was huge, with frizzy blonde hair. The angels came on and behind began to sing. Away in a manger, no crib for a bed. And the doll spoke. As she rocked it, it spoke. It said, hi, my name is Tammy. And I need my diapers changing. Hi, what's your name? My name is Tammy. Mary looks at Joseph. Joseph looks at Mary. They both look at the doll. Joseph said, give it to you. Boom! Boom! The head of the doll. Boom, boom, boom. Angels behind. The little Lord Jesus laid down his sweet head. Angel. One of the shepherds. I get it. Gives it back. See, I love nativities. I was in Halifax. I said to the infants, what's the name of the special baby born on the 25th of December? Wayne. I said, no, it wasn't. It were Wayne. I said, it was not Wayne. It was Jesus. It were Wayne. We've done it. They all start to sing. Wayne in a minute. Little girl outside of school. She's only six. They've just had the nativity play. They've just had the nativity play. She's crying her little eyes out. And I say, oh, come over here. What are you crying for? Well, what? What's your name? My name's Mary. And they keep calling me virgin and I'm not. Three wise men. The first one comes on. At the rehearsal, he was fine. When he sees his granny on the front row, it all changes. He comes on with his gold, sees his granny. Granny very unhelpfully. Teacher off stage, Dwayne, put the gold down. Put the gold down and come off. Dwayne Merriweather, get off this stage now. She prevails upon him to get off the stage. The next is a little girl, being the age of equal opportunities. She has seen the faces out there. She's terrified. You can hear her off stage. I don't want to do it. Yes, you do. I don't want to do it. Get on that stage now with the Mer Kimberly Bannister. I can't do it. She's projected on. Didn't do it. Come off. She goes off. Last little lad comes on as bold as brass, places the gift before baby Jesus and says, oh, and Frank sent this. one of the ones, the nativity, the nativity that he had, they had us all in tears. It was that special moment. You know, it was a special moment because Mary and Joseph, these little ones, were terrified when they came on. They were so nervous and everybody went, oh, and they were holding hands close together and Mary was nearly in tears. You could see her bottom lip. And Joseph was near it as well. They got to the inn. The innkeeper said, yes. Have you any room in the inn? Pardon? Have you any room in the inn? No. Please, no. Mary's going, I've got my wife here. And she's having a baby. Everybody's going, teacher ahead at the front going, oh, please. We've only got the barn round the back, but I've got my wife here. And keeper says, all right, then, you come in, I'll sleep in the barn. But he said, no! Don't. Yeah, when I was in Glasgow, the nun told me a lovely story. She said, I did the talk for parents, and at the end of the talk, she said, hey, she said, well, Gervase has done a lovely talk for us parents, and we're very grateful to him for coming up to do that. But he has gone on, she says, rather longer than I anticipated. So I wonder if you could help by moving the chairs back to the side of the hall, because it is getting late and the caretaker and I are anxious to get to bed. Going on a train over to Edinburgh, to the mother house in the 60s. Carriages went in early morning, commuters, five men. They all stand up as the little nun comes in. They offer a seat. She sits in the midst of them. And the conversation turns to the weather or something like that. After a while, she recognises the man who sits opposite her as being the father of a child whom she teaches. So when there's a lull in the conversation, she taps him on the knee and says, you know, I have an idea. You're the father of one of my children. And then I go to Wales. The last time I was in Wales, I was at the St David's Hall, and the manager said, a woman, Blodwyn, said, are there any Welsh people here tonight? If you are, you're proud of it, and you'll tell me, yeah. She came home, she said, Gervase, she said, you know, you're in the dressing room that was last occupied by Jean Pitney. He used the same toilet and wash basin and the same towel. He's been washed. But Jean Pitney, I went all wobbly when I met him. Right. He's dead, you know. I said, oh, yeah. Oh, yes, she said he did his last performance at St. David's Hall and sadly died. He was found at the Hilton Hotel. Where are you staying, Gervase? The Hilton Hotel. Well, good luck. Love Wales, the land of the teacher and the preacher. And sometimes I think back to my own school days at the high school in Rotherham, where a lot of my teachers were Welsh, Dr. Williams and Taffy Davis, Bobbin John Jones, all these different characters. Many of them had come out of the war. They'd been fighting in the war. One, Mr. Price, was in a Japanese prisoner of war camp. Never spoke about it to us. Amazing teachers and changed people's lives. And probably I'm asked sometime, who is the teacher that was the very best teacher you ever, ever saw? And I think it has to be a Welshman called Mr. Griffith. And when I was leading an inspection in a very difficult inner city school, a very difficult school, I said to the head, I'd like to do, in those days of Ofsted, a pupil pursuit. You follow a pupil round for the day in different lessons. English, geography, chemistry, and RE. That was the Friday. I said I'd come in early before the team arrived, all 15 of them, to follow a pupil round to get a feel for the school. The head teacher said, well, fine, and he introduced me to Debbie in the school library. Debbie looked as if she was going clubbing. She had a very short skirt on, black stockings, fancy shoes. She had her hair done up, makeup, and various assorted studs. Her friend, Tracy, had a stud through the centre of her tongue. And as I was talking to Debbie, she was next to her going... I said, Tracy, why have you got a stud through your tongue? To express my personality. So Debbie said to me, so what are you going to be doing then? What am I going to be doing? Yeah? I'm going to be following you around for the day. Why? Well, because I'm going to watch you in different lessons. Oh, it's dead boring. Well, I'll make up my own mind on that. At this point, a skinhead arrived. Head like a bullet. Studs right up his ears. He had tattoos on his knuckles, love and hat. He had tattooed scissors here, little scissors, and a dots. And over his windpipe, the word cut. He told me the following week his friend Dean had done his own in the mirror, the scissors and the dots and the... But because it was in the mirror, he was destined to go through the rest of his life with tuck. This boy had tattooed tears down his cheek. It was a frightening sight. And he ignored me and said to Debbie, who's he in Sue? He's following me around for the day. That wants to tell somebody. Now he's an inspector. Looks like a copper. He's not a copper. What is he then? School inspector. What's he do? Note. I am here. You can speak to me. I don't want to speak to you. And don't eyeball me. Those teachers deserve medals. First lesson, the English teacher tried her level best to gain their interest. She was good, but they didn't give her a chance. And Dean leans back on his chair while she's talking and says to me, she's not up to much, is she? I said, would you just shut up? Keep your clever comments to yourself. Then all the class turned around and went, Next lesson, geography. Then a geography was retiring. He says, I'm leaving this school. It's like Rob Wilton, the old comedian. I'm leaving this school, he said. At the end of this term, hallelujah. Like the Christians and the Lions here, Mr. Phinn, he said. If you think you can do any better, have a go. I'm opening an elf food shop in Mablethorpe. I'll be selling dried prunes at this time next year. Next lesson, chemistry. The chemistry teacher said, run that past me again, Mr. Phinn. Equipment. With these. You mean acids? Chemicals? He said, I don't give them rulers, a chapman. Dean was the ringleader. But then came Friday, the last two periods was RE with Mr. Griffith. And Debbie said, he's a right laugh. I thought out of some charity I would go. But they lined up and they were quiet. And I was intrigued. I expected around the corner to come a huge Welshman who played rugby. But around the corner came a diminutive man in a 1950s circa tracksuit, bright orange with a purple stripe, skin-tight bottoms. His frizzy hair was out here. He looked as if he'd struggle up an embankment after a derailment. And clutching in his hand, he had a mug of tea. And he shouted down the corridor. The boys were bigger than me. I was at the end. And he shouts down, who's that? He said at the back. Come out. Dear, a school inspector, we are greatly honoured today to have one of the Queen's inspectors with us. Oh, you are in for a rare treat with us this afternoon, Mr. Phinn. Really? Oh, yes, a rare treat. Well, I knew I was in for a rare treat, because on the side of this mug was written, sticks and stones may break my bones, but whips and chains excite me. I thought, well, something wrong here. He said, are you coming, he said, Mr. Phinn, and sit at the back of the room in the corner next to Dean. And don't talk too fast, otherwise they'll be up and dancing. Of course, I have a very easy time with these, you know. Being the head of RE, not like the head of English, I have an easy time. Really? Oh, yes, because I only have the one set book. I sat at the back and I tried to recover some lost ground with Dean. I said, Dean, tell me, how many studs have you in your ear?
What?
Well, I'm thinking of having one done.
Are you? Don't have them done at jewellers, do them yourself.
I do. You freeze your lobes with two ice cubes, you get a cork, stick it behind, get a needle, heat it up on gas and shove it through. Well, sometimes it goes green like that and up there. May we start, Mr. Phinn? Yes, of course. Now, I'm a Christian myself, and I've heard the Easter story many, many times. But on that November afternoon, in a stuffy classroom, these youngsters were there, and so was I. Now, we got up to the part last week, if you remember, where Pontius Pilate had washed his hands of Jesus. Do you know what they did then? No, sir. Great big whip. Was it Big Francine? She went, oh. And they scourged him. I'm going to write it on the board because it's a good word, that scourge. Pity we can't do it in schools, Mr. Phinn. Bit of scourging to do Dina Power good. They scourged him. Do you know what they did then? No, sir. They laughed at him and spat at him and cursed him and kicked him and mocked him and said, if you are the Son of God, the King of the Jews, show us. And you know, he could have. Oh, yes. He could have pointed at them and made them dust beneath his sandals. But he never did, see? He never did, because he used any power he had for good. And he loved people. And that's how they treated him. And the mob now were after blood. And they wrapped a piece of purple rag around him and laughed. And then a great cross over his shoulders. And I know probably he looked around on that day for a friendly face. But his friends had deserted him. And his best friend, Peter, had denied he knew him 3 times. And he was made to drag that cross through the streets to the Hill of Skulls, where they murdered him. And all he brought to the world was love. Dean's mouth was... And when they got him and they'd murdered him, but before they did that, before they nailed him to a cross, do you know what they did? And I heard myself say, no, sir. They got a crown of thorns. A crown of thorns, and they rammed it. He said they rammed it on his head. And Dean turned to me and nudged me and said, the bastards. We got out at the end of the lesson. He said, how did I do, Mr. Phinn? I said, I shall have to sit down, Mr. Griffiths. I said, my father was a Baptist preacher in Wales. He brought the Bible to life, see? If you think that was good, Mr. Phinn, do come back at Christmas. I do a lovely errand. See you in 20 minutes.